does help if I remember to unmute myself. So anyway, to speak, welcome to everyone who's joining us today on today's live stream. We have got the lovely Michael de Groot joining us this afternoon, and the even lovelier Muriel Gibbons joining us today as well. So if those who are joining us as we speak, if you could very kindly just share in the chat a little bit about who you are, what you're really passionate about, and go from there. And also, very importantly, just let us know you can hear us and see us okay as well. So that's always appreciated. So Muriel, I'll let you just check the live feeds on that one as well, if that's all right. Let's just kick things off sort of straight away. So just spare me a second while I get that all ready.
The other two live feeds are fine, Rupert.
Absolutely brilliant. Thank you ever so much, Muriel. Right. So what we're planning to talk about today with Michael is your brain is wired for stories and how you can implement this in your business. And I've had the great privilege of actually getting to see this content beforehand and actually preparing the slide deck. So it's going to be a great session with Michael. Michael, I'll unmute you as well, and Muriel as well, so you can obviously join in as appropriate. And moving on a little bit from there, what we plan to cover today is a whole range of different areas, but in particular, I just want to touch on very briefly for a second that do join in on the chat and, you know, basically just focus on building valued connections. So do interact with each other in the chat. And a number of you are regulars here every week. So it is about building on that deep relationship of trust. At the end of the day, that's absolutely vital because we all tend to know, do business with people we know, like, respect and trust. And as mentioned, if you've just joined us, do share what you're passionate about. No doubt Mike will have some ideas around that if you wanted to share that with everyone as well. Why you do it and how you like to make a difference. And do be bold with your questions. And even if we don't get to them straight away, we'll try and answer those through today's session. A bit of a quick introduction from me to start with. I founded Business Growth Bureau about 7 years ago. I feel very passionate in helping directors of companies to help them to grow their business and be much more successful. But even more importantly, I believe in the importance of circular relationships. A lot of people or companies, especially in large organizations, will talk about a so-called win-win. And when someone says that to you, invariably it means win-lose. It's just code for meaning the complete opposite. What I feel is really important is that you think of all the stakeholders who you work with, whether it be prospects, clients, partners, associates, employees, suppliers as well, and of course your directors, management team and staff, how you can add value there and how you can support people. And what you will find is if you do things the right way, that will come back in droves. And Muriel, do you want to share briefly what you're really passionate about as well?
Yes, thank you, Rupert. Yes, like you, I do love building relationships with people. I like to try and be ultra helpful and be on call for them, if you like. I do put in a lot to help people, but that's where I get my joy. So, you know, whether it be success in business or success in life, if I can help, then that gives me that buzz.
Yeah, great. Thank you very much, Muriel. That's brilliant. And a little bit of an introduction going from a slightly different tack before we get down to the meat of the presentation, which Michael's going to be sharing with us today. Those of you who are a bit new to us in terms of what we do, we love working with people to help them to bring their sales forward, amplify their brand and get their time back. And we've got what we class as the optimized systems for business growth. So it's about having your strategic dashboard so you know your key numbers, focusing your value brand proposition, what that looks like. And obviously, no doubt you'll get some great insights from Michael today. Everything to around brand amplification, and that's really about being able to do the job once and be able to get multiple leverage across different channels, but use technology to get your message out there on a bigger scale. And also what we class as social selling blueprint, which is lead generation, prospect nurturing, sales optimization. So you have a continual lead flow of new opportunities coming through and helping people to enhance the client journey so they So in effect, you can surprise and delight your customers and they become very active supporters of the organization. And they can also be some of your best referrers. And the amplification side is very much about all these areas. So you may start off with a video live stream and getting that across all the different social channels, including LinkedIn, YouTube, Facebook, and so on. What you can then do is repurpose that and then rebroadcast it a couple of weeks later. You can then take that content, do a little bit more of an edit. That goes out as a podcast. And Michael's a bit of an expert on that, actually, which we'll be talking about in just a second. How you can leverage social platforms as well to get your message out there, repurpose the content. So from one video interview, or it might be a podcast, you can repurpose that content and publish it to multiple platforms as lots of posts and articles or white papers or a downloadable book. How you can use technology in the way of video and also in terms of automated solutions, how you tie those platforms all together so they all talk to each other, and look at your entire sales optimization process so you can close more opportunities down, and what diagnostic tools can put in place to share more value. Anyway, I think very importantly, let's get down to the meat of this today. And so Michael, really over to you. So could you just tell us in sort of 2 or 3 minutes a little bit about your background, what you're really passionate about? And I'm also dying to know whether you've still got that Volkswagen.
Yes. Well, thank you, Rupert, and thanks for having me on your show. Really, really great to be here. So I'm a Dutchman. I've been in this country for over 40 years. So I call myself Dinglish. And I'm passionate about small businesses and helping small businesses succeed. Now, we do this in a slightly different way. Yours is a really interesting concept of all these cogs and strategic elements. We like to get people to really think about the medium for communicating their proposition and using storytelling to do that. And well, obviously, as we go into further, I can explain more why I think that this is absolutely right. But I enjoy doing that. I also enjoy interviewing small business owners. I'm talking about business owners with less than 9 employees, because that's probably the biggest amount of companies in this country. And I interview them so that other people can be inspired to start their own business, because I want to hear their story. That's why the podcast is called Share Your Story, about their journey in life and in business and where they've got to so far. And it's just really, really interesting for me to hear those stories, and they inspire me too. So those, in essence, are the kind of big things that I'm involved with. Apart from that, I'm passionate about kind of well-being. I do study a bit of mindfulness meditation, do a bit of yoga, do a bit of cycling now and again. And I love, absolutely love drumming. I used to be a drummer when I was a teenager, gave it up, but now I do Japanese taiko drumming. And I helped my teacher, actually, when we went into lockdown last year, to go online with his teaching, because he wasn't that good with technology. I am. So I supported him with all of the resources and videos and websites. And so that's been really an incredible journey as well over the past year.
Yeah.
So that's me.
That's fantastic. And have you got your teacher, as it were, to actually produce a YouTube video which has gone viral yet, by any chance, have you?
Well, no, not quite. He has got a video that's got a lot of views on it, but most of the videos that we produced have been unlisted videos, because they've been for a closed community where people pay for lessons and things. So we haven't gone public with it yet.
Oh, that's interesting. And Tell me a bit more about your Volkswagen. Have you still got a really nice Volkswagen van?
No, I've never had one. I've never owned one.
No. What's the story now? That was my illusion. I can imagine.
I know. Well, it kind of conjures up something in my mind anyway. You know, it's that going on the road to freedom type of thing, is, you know, going to the beach, doing a bit of surfing, just being free. And it's a great metaphor for life. And I just liked it. And we created that as an illustration to help the branding for my company.
Wow. Yeah, that's really interesting. You're definitely going to have to get one, though. You could probably put it down as a company expense, as a marketing expense.
Yeah.
I need to sell a lot of money these days as well, aren't they? So
I need a few more sales in order to achieve that. It's very expensive.
Yeah, exactly. But what we're going to share today, let me just run through these points with everyone who's joined us this afternoon. We're going to be talking about how storytelling affects your brain, research on the use of visuals, and I'm really keen to go through these with Michael and get his thoughts. And is it the Ebbinghaus forgetting yes. curve? Is that how you pronounce
yep.
it?
Yeah. Yep.
Good. And how you experience the hero's journey, and how yep. to implement this in your business from tomorrow. So some great points that we're going to be sort of sharing here, I think, Michael. It'll be really interesting to talk through some of these. So if we look at the storytelling part first, you've got this very elaborate diagram here. Could you very kindly talk us through this a little bit, if that's okay with you?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, first of all, to say that we were exposed to stories when we were very, very small. And therefore, our brain has been wired for stories from a very, very young age. But there are some important things that happen when we hear stories. And one of the things that happens is that we have developed ideas and experiences in our brain, and they're locked inside our neural network inside our brain. And when we hear other ideas and other messages and stories, we connect them in our brain with our existing experiences and ideas. And that's what's called neural coupling. For us to make sense of the world, we have to start with something, and that something is already inside of our brain. So we experience a story as if it's happening to us, number one. It's a really, really important one. Well, if it's already happening, if we believe it's happening to us, and there's a lot of research out there on this, and there is some activity that takes place, and it's an emotionally charged event, then dopamine, which I'm sure everybody's heard of, releases in the brain, and it reinforces it, and it makes sure that you're going to remember it. I mean, everybody remembers if they've had, you know, a very bad experience in their life, an emotionally charged event, they will remember it for the rest of their lives. And that's what happens. The dopamine is released in the brain, and you remember it for longer and with greater accuracy. But then also, there are parts in our brain that are responsible for movement of our limbs, of our hearing, our seeing. All of these things are activated in storytelling as well, because we already, whenever we hear a story, we start to create images in our brain, because otherwise the story just wouldn't have any value whatsoever. And once we create those images, back to saying we feel like we're already experiencing it, therefore all of the parts, like, you know, walking, talking, seeing, hearing, all of these parts in the brain are activated. And then the last thing is mirroring. We have empathy as human beings. And therefore, when we hear somebody speak and share an idea or a story, we also create that empathy with the speaker. So people that are listening to this talk now and hearing me speak, and the tone of my voice and my facial expressions, people are starting to experience and mirror some of those things as well. The other thing is, they also, and this happens a lot, if I pause because I'm going to say something else next, or I have a sentence, people often will try and anticipate what I'm going to say next. So everybody that was listening is already anticipating what I'm going to say next, because it's natural. We do this all the time when we're listening and speaking to people.
Well, that's really interesting.
Those are some of the things that affects the brain. So this is real science that takes place inside your brain.
Yeah, it's all really interesting. There's a question I've got for you. In fact, perhaps we could ask everyone who's joined us this afternoon, see where anyone knows the answer to it. Obviously, you must know the answer to this, but how many neurons do you have? As a matter of interest, if you may want to guess it's the closest number in billions. Any thoughts, or I'd be interested to see who comes up first with that answer. So do put your answer.
No Googling.
Should we allow people to cheat? I think we should allow people to cheat. why not? That's lovely. We'll come back and look at the answers in a minute to see how everyone's got on. So and there's another part which is really interesting around all of this as well, and that's what Richard Wiseman shares as well. First of all, who's Richard Wiseman?
Well, I don't know him personally. He's some renowned psychologist. You can definitely look him up on Google. But I tell you why I was fascinated by this research. So who are RSA Animate? RSA Animate are an arm of the Royal Society of Arts, where they created whiteboard animations. This goes back to like 2006 or 7. And they were speeches by famous people, like 15, 20 minutes long, like a TED talk, let's say. But it wasn't a TED talk, it was an RSA talk. And they then animated it with images and text and drawings in time with what the speaker was saying. And they were fascinated because they got a lot of views on YouTube on these, and they were going viral. And they wanted to know why people were so fascinated by it. So they did some research. They took 1,000 participants and they showed them a talking head video and then asked them some questions afterwards to see how much they remembered from the talking head video. And they remembered only about 70% of what was said. Then they took the same talk, just provided the audio and then the animation over the top of it. And when they asked people, and it was a good, you know, proper kind of study that they did, and it was, you know, very regulated, but 92% memory recall. Now, this was a 15% increase in recall, which in kind of the learning kind of industry, and I used to be in e-learning for a little bit, was a massive result. And they were very encouraged by it. Now, that was good news for me, because I was already by that time doing animations, whiteboard animations. So I went, oh, I must tell people about this because they will want more of my work. But they also realized when they did their research, they wanted to know, well, why is this happening? You know, why are people more interested? Why is the memory? Well, when you animate something, when you're drawing something on the screen and it's evolving and you see it happening, again, you're anticipating what's going to come next, but you're also curious to see what is going to come next. That means you're going to watch the video to the end because you want to see what the final reveal is going to be at the end of the drawing, let's say. And the information, they said, simply just goes in to the brain and people retain it for longer and they memorize it for longer. So this, what they say, you know, there's like there's knowledge going in, but there's also enjoyment. There's some art and people are fascinated by art and illustration, and they call it like edutainment. So it's entertainment and education in the same boat. And that's like the best part of it, really, for people to engage with the content.
Mm, that's really interesting, isn't it? And I mean, mind mapping is a methodology here. It's really interesting. It's obviously, this is a good example of a mind map as well, isn't it? In terms
Correct.
Of bringing the whole thing together, especially if you're, as a matter of interest, Michael, are you a very visual person? I guess you must be.
Well, I think
as well.
Pardon?
You must be strong auditorily as well, being a big fan of creating podcasts.
Yeah, I like both mediums, definitely. But I think everyone is visual, to be honest. I got into mind mapping a few years ago and I really enjoy it. And I do all my learning with mind mapping and my idea creation, I use mind mapping. So when I'm mapping something out for a client, I use mind mapping. When I attend presentations, I do mind mapping. And it just helps me retain information for myself better as well.
Yeah, no, it's interesting. So this is really what you refer to as being research on the visual side as well, is it? So do you tend to use mind mapping to do with that as well, and then also conveying the message? Do you find
I do think that, you know, we're seeing some slides, but they're very visual slides that I'm sharing. But if we've all been to presentations, not this one, of course, where people have got 600 slides and they're just, you know, words on slides. And the thing is, people are not going to remember that because we are visual people. And therefore, if I do a presentation, sometimes I just have one mind map up and I give people all of the information in one mind map. And then talk about what's on the mind map. Mm. We need to find visual cues in order to help people remember stuff. 100%.
Yeah, that's really good. I must admit, I'm very visual by nature myself, so I entirely relate to that. Probably not helped by the fact I can't write properly. In fact, Mira will vouch for the fact everything has to be done on a computer keyboard or an iPad. So because I get words and letters the wrong way around if I try and write things as well. So it's quite interesting. Now, we've just a bit of feedback for a few people here. Renato, welcome, and also Simon as well. Renato, I'm going to push you a little bit on this, actually. You've said it's billions in the human brain, but how many billions? You can't cheat and just say billions. And Simon Morris, you're cheating as well. How many stars are in the galaxy? Come and see if we can put a number on that question in terms of how many neurons do you have. So a bit of fun with this. So let's see how we go from there. Anyone else who wanted to drop in any questions or comments, do so, because Michael, I'm sure, would really welcome that. And so would Miral and myself. So Renato's saying 10 or so. Any advances or 10 or so on that one? We'll give everyone another minute or so to think about that. Let's go on to the next part. This leads in very nicely into Ebbinghaus's forgetting curve. So why forgetting rather than forgotten? But anyway, that's another matter. But could you just explain this a little bit? It's a bit of an intriguing one as well.
Yeah, so, we all know that we attend presentations or talks like this, and by tomorrow, if we haven't made any notes, by tomorrow we will have forgotten a little bit of it. And then the day after, we'll have forgotten a little bit more. And then in 7 days, we will have forgotten 90% of what we heard on day one.
90%?
90%, yeah. And that is the Ebbinghaus research that this guy did. And I found it fascinating because I had a spell in the e-learning industry and it's 100% true. People just forget stuff. Go to on a training course, you've been there for a day or two and you're doing really great work, but in a few weeks, it's all gone. It's all gone. But we have to do something if we want to put stuff into long-term memory in our brain. I'm not a brain expert. I know we're talking about the brain a lot here, but it's back to these visual cues, but also asking the individual to do something with the information that they have received. They've got to take some action. So people that are watching this, even if they're watching it live or on replay, you must take some action with the information that you're hearing today, definitely tomorrow, and in a couple of days more, or maybe in a week's time, in order to retain the knowledge that you might wish to retain. Yeah. Even if you've made notes, it's going to go. It's going to go.
You made me really think, actually, because we've got our mini conference next week. And, you know, I love producing what I feel is interesting content with lots of pictures and some words in it. And, yeah, and I always think you got to be careful because PowerPoint is a great tool, but you could also die through PowerPoint as well, can't you? So, yeah, so this forgetting curve is a really interesting point. It does pose another question, though, around that too. And it's something as well we talk a lot about as far as the sales optimization system is concerned, because you can slightly tie it back to the whole sales process. Is a lot of people don't understand the importance of getting back to people quickly as well. So someone might put their hand up and say, oh, thanks for sharing me that information. I'd love to have a conversation, or I'd love to understand a bit more about what you do. And what you tend to find, especially these days, we all suffer with information overload, that that those leads or opportunities, literally, they cool down literally over hours, let alone days.
Yes. Yeah,
and I think this whole part around Ebbinghaus, the forgetting curve, is a really interesting one. And has he written a few books, has he? And is he on Audible? It's very interesting, you know?
I don't know. I just know of his research, and I know about this forgetting curve, and I know it happens to me. So, I know it happens to me unless I do something with the information I've watched or heard. If I really want to remember it, and then I must practice, put it into practice, or go back to it and revise it again.
So that's really interesting. And we've had a guess at the number of neurons do we have. Renato said 10 or so. Where's the number?
10 billion, she said.
Yeah, 10 billion.
There's another one from Simon saying over 100 billion.
Oh, right. So I didn't see that one. So,
yeah.
What's the right answer?
So Simon is the closest. It's around 86 billion.
You're joking.
Yeah.
It's amazing, isn't it? Yeah.
And remember, a lot of them are dormant. We don't do anything with them.
Yeah. Wow. I one of the things, a slight deviation again here, but I'll leave it to the person on air today if they want to share anything here today. But I've come across three people over over about 3 or 4 months who had actually had some serious accident some years earlier, where perhaps think of one case where someone fell down the escalators, which was at Green Park, and it's strangely enough the other person fell down the escalators down at, I think it was Oxford Circus, and both suffered quite severe brain injury. And someone else who I know as well, who was a different type of accident. But the amazing thing is the person that did a lot of damage to themselves and was in a coma for about 2 months. The other one was nearly as severe. The amazing thing is the brain sort of rewired itself in both cases. Also sometimes it rewires itself in all sorts of strange ways. So you get people who perhaps suddenly have skills which they didn't know they actually even had before. So that subject in itself must be a really interesting one. What we'll do is we'll come back to some other comments in the chat. And I think, Renato, if you're happy to share in the chat, please do. Obviously, I'll leave that one to you because it ties in very much with the topic today. But I won't put you any more on the spot than that. We'll come back to these conversations. But I think what would be really nice is to move on to the next point, if that's right. And Renato will come back to you in a minute, if that's okay. So how about this one? Spaced repetition. What's this all about?
Yeah, so it's kind of answering the question, well, how do we remember longer, for longer? And that is through spaced repetition. And it is actually a learning modality, spaced repetition. Often this is used in language learning, where people use like cards, you know, and you you get the, say, the English on the front of the card and the translation on the back. And when you see the English, you've got to try and remember what the translation is and then turn it around. And then if you get some right, you put them on one deck of cards. And if you get them wrong, you put it on another deck of cards. And then tomorrow, you go and study the ones that you didn't get right. And then in a few days, you'll get through all of them and you remember it. And but it's through spaced repetition that they go in. So what this is saying, that if you look at the information again, you kind of engage with it again the next day. Like in one day, it's saying you lose 60%. So you're back up to 100% after one day when you've looked at it. Then when in 3 days' time, you lose another, you know, say 40% or whatever, and then you top it back up to 100%. And then in 6 days' time, you do the same. And now it's starting to be sent to long-term memory at that stage. So now you're going to remember it for much longer, and you lose very little of it. Because once you've had the information, you've done something with it, you've engaged with it, and you start to put it into your long-term memory banks by the spaced repetition. So looking at it tomorrow, in a few days' time, in a few days' time again, over the next 7 days.
Wow.
That's it.
That's really interesting. And I'd love to know this answer as well. How do people, is it Dale Carnegie? I can't remember it. He talks about how, because if you get a room full of perhaps 15 or 20 people, how do some of these people remember people's names in the room? You know, I can't remember, barely remember one or two, let alone 15 or 20. But what techniques do people use in that type of situation?
There are many different techniques that people can use for memory retention. I'm not an expert on memory retention. For example, particularly when it comes to names, if you get introduced to someone and you say hello to them, the first thing you must do is repeat their name back to them. So if I was introduced to you and somebody said, "Oh, hi, Michael, this is Rupert," and I kind of shook your hand and went, "Oh, hi, nice to meet you," I should say your name. And then I should look at perhaps a distinguished feature of you that I can link that name to. So I see you've got glasses on, so I can go, "Ah, Rupert with the glasses." I don't say that out loud, but I might say, "Nice to meet you, Rupert." And if I need to know your surname, I'll say, "Nice to meet you, Rupert Honywood." Honywood, is it? Or something like that. Because once I'm saying it, I have a better chance of then remembering it next time.
Right. Wow. That's interesting, isn't it? There's a great sketch in the American version of The Office. I've got completely hooked on that, actually.
All right.
Yeah, I do own up to watching probably one episode every other day.
But a brilliant
episode where basically he's trying to teach memory recall techniques to people in the room. And, of course, in very, very bad taste, he refers to people in the form of different types of animals, and you can obviously tell exactly where this conversation is going. And the only way to describe it is a car crash, and all sorts of people get upset in the office about it. But one thing was sure, that people did remember.
It's
staggering. And I think, Mira, I can't really sort of read it very well, but I think Renato's sort of shared a bit what happened to him. And are you able to read that out, Emiro?
I'll give it a go. Right, so 11 years ago in tackle playing football, broke his right fibula and knocked to the head, forgotten. Till headaches 12 years later showed lesion artery and object 5 centimetres in diameter pressing on the left temporal lobe. So urgent surgery operation. They removed venous malformation. Thanks, Rupert. malformation of left temporal lobe and risk of losing speech and short-term memory from area of operation. The morning after, amazed doctors and surgeons to be in full conversation with the intensive care nurses. They discovered the brain new weakness in the left temporal lobe and had used what we now call plasticity of the brain, where speech dual sourced with back to of brain and short-term memory with the right temporal lobe. Hence now in a MRI, left temporal lobe just fluid now, and all functions in other regions of the brain will function with full function.
Yeah. Amazing.
Yeah, it is absolutely stunning. And Renato is quite a regular on this program, and it's almost regarded Renato as a friend now. But Renato, if anyone knows him, is a very, very clever man who happens to have about 500 people working for one of the largest telecoms companies in the world. I'm not saying any more than that. So it is amazing how the brain can be very, really adapt to different situations as well. So some great sharing there. So thank you, Renato. Obviously, any of the rest of you, if you've got some thoughts or ideas or anything you'd like to share, please do. I really like to hear from you. And I think we've got another really interesting one here, haven't we, which the hero's journey. Now, I'm not sure how well it comes out on the screen on your side here, on the other end. So you might need to read some of these parts out, if that's okay, Michael. But yeah, talk us through this. That's all right.
I'm not going to read all of them out because everybody is already familiar with this. So basically, we are all on the hero's journey, right? We basically live the same journey. All our stories are the same. We get born, we have parents, we have maybe siblings, we learn to walk, we learn to talk, we go to school, we learn to eat as well. We go to school, we have education, maybe further education. We want to then make a living in the world and find a job. Maybe we get married and have kids ourselves. Not always happen that way, but maybe we do. And then eventually we achieve the things we want to achieve, and we have lots of challenges on the way. Lots of challenges. Everybody goes through suffering. Everybody has issues. Everybody has things that they need to overcome. And then eventually we grow old. We have disease in some way. The body doesn't uphold the way it wants to uphold. And we perish at some point. So all of our stories are the same. And therefore, when Joseph Campbell, who is a very famous writer of Greek mythology, kind of developed this concept of the hero's journey, it only became really well known when George Lucas, who came across it, did it and applied it to the first Star Wars movie.
Wow.
And when it was applied, and before that time, movies were not really following this thread that much. But now, rarely is there a movie now that doesn't follow the same kind of concept. Most stories talk about an individual who is a reluctant hero. He's called upon, or she's called upon, to, go on a conquest, but they don't want to go. But somebody convinces them that they are the one that has got to go on this conquest. They are the chosen one. And then they have to overcome all of these challenges, and they come across a teacher. They think they are a failure at some point. They are no good for doing this. But then they get a mentor or a teacher who teaches them some skills, gives them some magic powers. Maybe they were born with magic powers already as well. And then they start to save the planet, the world, save people, achieve things. And then eventually they go home. They call it atonement. And they return home as the hero who's been on this conquest, has overcome all of these challenges, and lives to tell the tale to their tribe, basically. And most movies follow this thread. And we are hooked. The message is we are hooked on those stories. We love these stories because we can relate to them. We go, well, that's like me. You know, I've got the same issues. I mean, okay, with a superhero movie, it may not be quite the same as my life, but I empathize. I want the superhero to win and overcome and beat the baddies. And, you know, the stories are all the same. There are just different characters. There's a different plot. There's a different storyline. There's a different time and place and, you know, circumstances. They may be on Mars or they may be in the sea or on the bottom of the sea. It doesn't matter. It's all the same story. And that's why we enjoy them so much.
Wow, that's interesting, actually. That's seriously interesting. To note, it was also ties back to the first Star Wars movie as well. When was the first Star Wars movie produced? Was
1977.
It about, was it? That's going to be 1970s, yeah.
And that was the year I came to the UK. I queued around the block for the Odeon Leicester Square. And those were the days when you didn't know if you were in a queue, whether you'd get a ticket or not. Luckily, I did get a ticket and I was mesmerized by the movie. It was just unbelievable. Never seen anything like it at the time.
Well, that's interesting. Well, that's really good. Now, we're going to come back to this in just about 3 or 4 minutes' time. I'm just going to share a little bit more information. And we've got some great questions about to follow on from this, actually. But those of you who joined us today, do ask in the chat, ask any relevant questions. Make it a curveball question. Michael told me before he came on today that he loves curveball questions. So,
oh, yes.
Yeah, let's go for it. We'll come back in the next 3 or 4 minutes. In terms of how we, as an organization, tend to like to help people as well as... We recognise as well that we're all travelling a really lonely journey in this place, as it were, whether we're a company of one or a company of 1,000. And it's just the problems tend to be a little bit different. We want to be here for you to help you in your business growth. And if you are enjoying today, do feel free to share this session today on Facebook and YouTube. And also, you very well to hit subscribe and... So that way you can be kept in the loop. And in terms of next week, we've got a really interesting guest join us. We've called David Foxpick. He got an MBE as well a few years ago. And there's a saying, if you want something done, ask a busy man or a woman. Okay. And he's a living, breathing example of that. He's also a little bit eccentric. I'm sure he wouldn't mind me saying that. And he's got, in addition to all his... major things he's done, especially around the COVID scenario with making sure nurses and doctors had sort of food supplies made available to them as they came in out of hospitals. And, you know, I think organized about 300 or 400 meals a day with local venues in Edinburgh. He also is responsible for running the quadrathlon in Scotland, where normally has about 400 people taking part. Some events in, I think it's the Oban area, and also is down in this neck of the woods in the southeast in a few weeks' time, taking part in a big event which he's organised. But he's got a very unusual interest as well, and that's in penny farthings. I don't want to say it's thunder, but what I will say, he was wearing a Roman hat when doing it, and was wearing a kilt as well. I'll leave the rest to your imagination. Okay. But he's going to be sharing next week about having passion and burning desire to get things done. So in other words, under make a plan and just do it. Accepting the mission before you start the challenges. Tap into subconscious mind and talk about mind mapping there with brilliant colours. Wow, that ties in well. Yeah. And procrastination is the biggest killer. I think we're all guilty of that. And simply persist and tackle the obstacles head on. So it's going to be a really fun session next week. So do join us. And a quick reminder of what we've talked about before, which I'm not going to go into again, but we have got our mini conference next Tuesday from 3 to 5 o'clock. We're going to follow a bit of a different format. It's going to be a little bit more focus group based next week. And we're going to have lots of fun with that. And I'll remember to take out some of those slides. That's what's being shared today. And in terms of being able to make sure you are included with these, to register for the mini conference, you can just go to the homepage of our website, and there's a button there where you can register for that. Equally, there's an on-demand webinar, which you can just join us anytime, ask questions in real time, and also you get an opportunity to complete diagnostic book call-in with myself and Muriel. And to register for these Thursday sessions, one of the things we recommend you do is you can just choose continue in the calendar system when you've chosen the date. But if you choose the recurring option, the system will automatically send you reminders for the following week's event. So it saves you having to re-register each week. And in terms of how you can get some useful information back, you can very well complete a diagnostic, which is on the businessgrowthbureau.tv/diagnostic link. It takes about 4.5 to 6.5 minutes to complete, and you get a really nice personalized 8-page report based on your responses there. And that's really useful, because if we then speak with you, which there's no cost for that, then we're able to share a lot more value as part of that call. That's for you to keep. Also, what I'd like to do as well is to share the contact details. In particular, Michael obviously shared very generously his time today. I'm very grateful, Michael, for that as well.
Pleasure.
Yeah, and his web address is stayingaliveuk.com. So it's not .uk.com, it's stayingaliveuk.com. And if I've got the number correct there, it's 07866471596. And Michael can be contacted directly on this email address, which is below. So it's michael@stayingaliveuk.com. So I know, Michael, you're always very keen to work with people and have a great passion and interest. And obviously, if you're interested in taking part in this podcast as well, I think, how many episodes have you done of the podcast so far to date, as a matter of interest,
Michael? About 110.
Wow, 110. Mm. That's staggering. So how long have we been doing those over?
Well, I started in 2016. So, you know, some months, not so many, some years, not so many. So last year, obviously, with the pandemic, there weren't that many guests. So it ebbs and flows. And then all of a sudden I get a lot of influx. And but yeah, I really enjoy them and enjoy interviewing people, enjoying giving value to the small business world.
Nice. Yeah, I really, really like that. It's quite something to get over the 100 mark as well. And in fact, we got to know each other through LinkedIn, if I recall correctly. Then you very kindly invited me onto your podcast, didn't you? About 18 months ago. So that was a lot of good fun with that. Now, there is a bit more of a question I'd love to ask. And I'm trying to be aware if there's any questions being asked in the chat. Obviously, do drop those in. In fact, Simon Morris has very kindly shared a URL there. Simon's shared a very interesting URL there, so that might be useful.
Yes. Yeah, I've grabbed it, so I will definitely look at that. Thank you very much indeed, Simon. That's really good.
Excellent. If you're on YouTube and Facebook, because it's being streamed over that, the URL will still be here afterwards as well. So that's really appreciated, Simon. So I think the sort of question really is, how do you start implementing what we've talked about today in your business starting from tomorrow?
So people can take some action literally tomorrow by starting to embed some of the concepts that we talked about. So one area you could do, I have a free storytelling workshop, which is about an hour long video. It's a replay of a virtual workshop that I did online. And if people go to my website, which is stayingaliveuk.com, they click on more in the menu item, you'll see storytelling workshop. You can sign up on that. It's absolutely free. I zeroed the price when we went into the pandemic, and I've left it like that. And I probably will just leave it like that. I also believe that it's important for people to look at their LinkedIn. Now, you help people with their LinkedIn so they can get your support with this. And that is, look at rewriting the summary in the form of a short story rather than either write it in the third person, which a lot of people do, or saying, I do this, I do this, I do this, I do this. Actually, write a short story about why you think what you do really helps people or companies or individuals, whatever. So that's action point number two. Action point number three, what I've learned, and specifically when I started doing podcasting, because when I invited people on the podcast, I have to ask them for a bio, which I use in the show notes. And I was amazed how few business people actually have a written biography. And again, that can be in the form of a story. You know, it doesn't have to be long. It can be a really short story. It's a challenge to try and summarize your life, whether personal or business, in a short story, in a biography. But I think it's really important if you want to get onto podcasts, let's say, and share what you do, because that's a great way to get known. If you have a biography, it makes the work for podcasters, interviewers, so much easier. Mm. So those are three things that I think people could really take some action in terms of embedding some of the concepts that they've heard today.
Mm. That's interesting. I'm going to be a bit unfair here, actually, Michael, and I do apologize for this in advance, but we talked about this beforehand, so it shouldn't be a complete surprise. But what recent challenge did you overcome over the last work recently?
Well, the main challenge I overcame more recently, was probably the kind of the pandemic that we've been in. So my workload really took a dive, and it was quite concerning at one point. But I thought, well, there's a pandemic on, it's only natural. And as we went into lockdown, I actually got three or four projects. So it kept me going for about 4 months or so, and then things started drying up. And then as we're starting to kind of come out of it more recently, I mean, I got very involved in the taiko drumming bit that I said earlier in terms of helping my teacher. And I had to make a tough decision in terms of reducing the amount of work I was doing for him, most of which was pro bono. He was paying me just a bit of pocket money for it. Because of my love of drumming, I wanted to give back to that industry, I suppose, the taiko drumming community. So I did a lot of research in terms of what's my next step going to be. And I joined an organization called Screen Skills. And I thought maybe I go into film and TV in terms of becoming a production manager or doing something else. And through learning online and attending events and things, I discovered that actually I wanted to stay with animation. And I found through that journey a great program which would allow me to take my product that I offer to the next level, which is 2D animation. And wow. I'm now studying that. I've been on a boot camp for 3 weeks. Now I'm on a course for 5 weeks, and probably it's a 6 month to 12 month journey for me to get my teeth into 2D animation. But I was kind of in a dark place in terms of where my business was going with all of the pandemic stuff that's been happening. But I'm now kind of reinvigorated, really, because I can see something new on the horizon, something that I'm learning, which is always really great that you're learning something new. At the beginning, it was a bit of a challenge, but now I'm kind of going with the flow of it. So,
An interesting question around this as well is I know with a dog, it seems very random, this question, but I've got to ask it. I think they say with a dog, and we're sort of dog lovers, so
yes,
they say a dog, you have to teach it to do something 500 times before it actually learns what you said. And obviously, I think it depends how clever or not your dog actually is. But in our case, it's probably 1,000 times. But
treats. Yeah. You need to give him treats.
In our case, it's a ball. If you give him a ball, he's...
Yeah, oh, great, yeah. Yeah. Toy.
How many times do you have to do that with human beings before it starts to become a habit or it comes a positive reinforcement? Any ideas of anyone in the chat, by the way? If you know the answer,
got my own non-scientific view on this. And they say that if you repeat something every single day for about 3 weeks, 21 days, then it will kind of go in, you know, becomes a new habit. The trouble is, it is no good developing a new habit if you haven't got a worthwhile why. Mm. Why are you doing it? What is the reason? If you need a strong anchor to say, I'm going to do this because, you know, it could be because you want to provide for your family. That's really important to you. It could be because you want to become known in your industry for something. It could be because you want to give to people that are, you know, vulnerable or whatever it might be. You've got to have a big why before you start with developing this new habit. So for me, say the 2D animation, my big why is I want to make sure my business is still around in a year's time, you know, because I'm not ready to give it up yet, for example. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. So about 21 days, do something every single day, but it won't stick. It won't become a new habit if you don't have a big enough why.
Yeah, love it. I think on that note, it's a really good place to leave this show today. And it's interesting, we got to this and actually we finished up on that point because we all have to build, focus ourselves on what is really our why, don't we? And if our personal why and our business why is properly aligned, then we're really, can achieve great things. I'm not sure who that is. We're just seeing it as Facebook user. And Miro, can you just read that for a second? Oh, it's Nikki, is it? Yeah.
Dr. Maxwell Maltz, a plastic surgeon in the 1950s, was the start of suggesting that it might take 21 days to start a new habit. He noticed that patients took 21 days to get used to their new look.
Oh, brilliant. 21 days. Oh, that's a brilliant story. Thank you, Nikki. Yeah, that's awesome.
Lovely.
I never knew that, but I love the plastic surgeon reference. That's awesome.
That's great. Well, thanks very much for joining us today as well. And if you're watching this via catch up, which a lot of people do, we find probably 4 or 5 times more people watch this afterwards, interestingly enough. Then do get in touch. You know Michael's details now, and Miro and myself are always very pleased to help. And thank you very much for joining us today. And we loved you taking part. So take care, everyone. We'll see you next week. So thank you very much. Take care.
Thank you, Rupert. Thank you, Muriel. Great to be here. Cheers. Bye.